today we are going to see the Bohr's model of an atom and quantum mechanical model of an atom, how it arises. As we all know, Rutherford model of an atom attained failure due to the inability to explain the stability of an atom. So today we are going to see Bohr-Sommerfeld model of atom, which is based completely on quantum mechanical model of an atom. First, we all know Bohr model of an atom says that electrons revolve around the nucleus in fixed path called orbit. In this fixed path, each electron is associated with a certain amount of energy, but nothing happens to the energy when the electron is in that fixed orbit and revolve around the nucleus. No energy is emitted when the electron is in that fixed orbit. Then, how the electron is able to go around the nucleus? As we all know, how sun is at the center and planets are revolving around the sun. Likewise, centrifugal force due to the revolving of the electron, that is minus mv square by r, that is the centrifugal force, which is balanced by the electrostatic force of attraction. You know, nucleus and the electron, they will have the attraction. That is called electrostatic force of attraction. The force of attraction and the revolving force, both are balancing each other, which is nothing but minus z e square by r. So both are equal. Minus mv square by r and minus z e square by r are equal. Then next point, Bohr's model of an atom says that an electron, if it wants to be in that particular orbit, it goes in the form of wave we have seen. Then it is a lambda, the thrust, successive thrust, the distance between the successive thrust is lambda. So when the electron goes around the orbit, this circle line is the orbit. When the electron goes around the orbit, you know very well, it has to make complete, see, for example, in this, it is making from here to here 1 lambda, then 2 lambda, 3 lambda, then 4 lambdas. It is making some integral multiples of lambda is covered by the electron. That is nothing but the distance covered by the electron is 2 pi r. That is the circumference of the circle. Am I correct? So this orbit, which is assumed to be a circle, is covered by n times lambda. Then only that particular electron can be in that particular orbit. If the 2 pi r, that is the circumference of the orbit, is not equal to n lambda. For example, it is 5 lambda, it is making. The lambda is 5 picometer. Then it should be 5 into 5 should be 25 picometer. That should be the 2 pi r. Then only that particular electron can be in that particular orbit. If it is 24 or 23, then that electron cannot be in that particular orbit. Then angular momentum. You know all of you, mvr is the angular momentum. This angular momentum, m is the mass of the electron, v is the velocity of the electron, r is the radius of the electron. This angular momentum must be equal to integral multiple of h upon 2 pi. H upon 2 pi. H is Planck's constant. You all know 2 is an integer. Pi is 3.14 value. Then Bohr's model says that whenever an electron is in its fixed orbit, then it will not emit out any energy. When it jumps from one orbit to the another orbit, lower orbit to the higher orbit, from the gas shell, it is going to the L shell. Orbit, shell, everything makes the same mean. When it goes from K shell to L shell or any other higher shell, it absorbs energy. But it cannot stay for a long time in the higher energy. The electron cannot stay. So it will come back. How it will come back? It will emit out energy. So it absorbs energy in order to go to the higher level. It emits out energy when it is coming to the lower level. So what is the energy change? Whatever is the energy in the lower level, and you know the energy at the higher level. When you subtract them, you will get the energy required for the excitement. Same amount of energy also will be emitted out when it comes back to the lower energy. That is called E to minus E1, or we can say E final minus E initial. That is equal to the delta E. That is the change in energy. Now we are coming to know These are the postulates proposed by Bohr. Now we are coming to the radius of the orbit. How to calculate the radius of the orbit? Already we know, according to Bohr, the angular momentum of an electron in an orbit must be integral multiple of h upon 2 pi. So what is the velocity? Velocity of that electron in that particular orbit will be equal to n into h divided by 2 pi into n into r. This is velocity. So what is v square? N square h square by 4 pi square m square r square. This is the velocity centimeter per second, centimeter square per second. Here it is centimeter per second. Velocity is meter per second or centimeter per second, like that we can measure. So it is v square. Now I am coming back to the second point of the Bohr's model. So we can calculate velocity, we can calculate radius, we can calculate energy of the orbit using which model of an atom? Bohr's model of an atom. Second point says that the centrifugal force of the electron due to revolving must be equal to the electrostatic force. So minus mv square by r is equal to minus z e square by r. Now you substitute the v square and calculate the r value, that is the radius of the nth orbit. K shell, L shell, M shell. What will happen when you move from the nucleus, when you move on the radius of the orbit? You see the K shell and the L shell, whose orbit is, whose radius is bigger? L shell orbit is bigger. I mean, correct, radius is bigger. So radius of any orbit, nth orbit is equal to 52.9 into n square divided by z. Z is the atomic number. N is the number of the orbit. We can write it in picometer, or if you want to convert it in angstrom, it will be 0.529 into n square by z angstrom. This is angstrom. N is the number of the orbit. Now we can calculate the energy of the orbit. Third point. Velocity we have calculated, radius of the orbit we have calculated, now we have calculated the energy of the electron in a particular orbit. That total energy will be equal to potential energy plus kinetic energy. Potential energy is minus z e square by r. Kinetic energy is half of that, half z e square by r. So when you take LCM and solve it, you will get minus z e square by 2r. Now substitute the r value, already we have calculated. It will come out as, if you calculate in joule per atom, it will come out as minus 2.18 into 10 power minus 18 into joule per atom for the first orbit. For the first orbit. Second orbit means you have to write 2 square in the denominator. Minus 2.18 into 10 power minus 18. I will write here energy of the orbit, nth orbit is equal to minus 2.18 into 10 power minus 18, minus 18 by n square into z square joule per atom. If you want to calculate in mole, joule per mole, then multiply it with Avogadro number, then it will come out as minus 1312 into 10 power 3 by n square joule per mole. How will you convert into kilojoules? Remove this 10 power 3, it will come out as kilojoules per mole. Joule per atom means minus 2.18 into 10 power minus 18 by n square into z square. Joule per mole means z and all will not come, only n square will come in the denominator. Minus 1312 into 10 power 3 joule per mole. This 10 power 3 if you remove means it will become kilojoules. Hope you have understood how to calculate radius, velocity and energy of an electron in any particular orbit. Radius of the orbit also we can calculate by using Bohr's model of an atom. Next video we are going to see merits and demerits of Bohr's model, how it move on to quantum mechanical model of an atom we are going to see. So we have seen energy can be emitted or absorbed when electrons jump from one orbit to the other orbit, or one shell to the other shell, from one energy level to the other energy level. Delta E is the change in energy that will be equal to h nu, that is quantized according to Bohr. So h nu, instead of nu we can write c by lambda. That is 1 by lambda is equal to nu bar. That is wave number. That is equal to delta E by hc. It has been calculated and simplified as 1,09,678 into 1 by n1 square minus 1 by n2 square. N1 square where it was in the beginning. N2 is the level where it has reached. Maybe from the top to bottom also it can come. N1 is the initial level, N final level. This is final level. This value is found out by Rydberg. So this constant is called Rydberg constant. In the book it might have written as RH. So they were asked, when an electron of hydrogen atom jumped from 5th orbit to 2nd orbit, what is the wave number of the light absorbed? Wave number means nu bar is equal to 1 by lambda. Then you have to substitute from which orbit to which orbit you have to write. That's all. You can find out this one centimeter power by this one. Instead of asking wave number, if they ask wave length, what will you do? First you calculate 1 by lambda. Then reciprocal of that you will get lambda. Wave length you will get. Then the energy again. It is, we are recalling, it is nothing but minus 1312 into 10 power 3 by n square joule per mole. It is for mole means this much value. If it is joule per atom means it is not multiplied by Avogadro number. So it will be minus 2.19 into 10 power minus 18. Here it is not minus, it is 10 power 3. When I remove this 10 power 3 only, it will become kilojoules. Please understand. Minus 2.19 in 10 power minus 18 by n square into z square. Z is nothing but the atomic number, joule per atom. Now we are coming to the fourth point. How to calculate? Fourth point in the sense, we have already calculated velocity, radius, energy. Now we are going to calculate number of lights produced during jump from nth level to ground level. From any infinity level, any level, it is coming to K shell. Then how many number of lines it is produced? That is calculated by the formula n into n minus 1 by 2. If an electron is jumping from 5th orbit, then how many spectral lines it will make? You put 5 here because 5th orbit, n is always denoting the number of the orbit. So 5 into 5 minus 1 is 4. 5 into 4, 5 fours are 20. 20 by 2, 10. 10 spectral lines. So how many spectral lines will come? You have to calculate. 6th orbit, how will you calculate? There is a question in the textbook also, NCERT textbook. 6 into 5 by 2, 30 by 2. So how many spectral lines it will produce? 15 spectral lines it will produce. Now we will come to the end of the Bohr's model of an atom by seeing the merits and demerits, limitations and achievements of Bohr's model. Merits of Bohr's model is it could explain the stability of the atom, which was not explained in Rutherford model of an atom. It was able to explain hydrogen spectrum, not only hydrogen spectrum, helium plus, lithium 2 plus, like this one electron system. Lithium's atomic number is 3. 2 plus means it has lost its 2 electrons, so only 1 electron is left out. 1 electron system. Helium atomic number is 2. It has lost its 1 electron, helium plus. So Bohr was able to explain only 1 electron spectrums, 1 electron containing atoms spectrum. Then the frequency nu, it is calculated value is almost equal to the experimental found value. But from the formula what we have calculated was really merging with the value which we have done by experimental. Then limitations. It is not explaining the multi-electron system. Multi-electron system means more than one electron is there. Means the spectral lines Bohr could not explain. Then Bohr failed in two things. One is Stark effect and Zeeman effect. What is Stark effect? What is Zeeman effect? The spectral lines we have seen, Lyman series, Molnar series, Molnar bracket, Fund series for hydrogen we have seen. If we see it in electric field, in applying electric field, one line is splitting into many lines. That was named as Stark. The Stark effect was not explained by Bohr. Zeeman effect, same one spectral line, Lyman series, if you allow to enter into the field, there was further splitting in the magnetic field. What was the reason? Who was not able to explain? Bohr was not able to explain. That effect was called, named afterwards, Zeeman. So Stark effect and Zeeman effect was not explained by Bohr, and he was not able to explain for multi-electron system spectral lines. Then he couldn't explain why atoms combine together to form compounds. Now we are coming to the Sommerfeld models postulates. He said electrons are not revolving in circular orbits, as Bohr said. He said it is an elliptical path. When the elliptical path goes further, further, when it goes beyond the nucleus to a large extent, it will automatically become a circle. So circular path is a special case of elliptical path. Then he also says angular momentum is quantized. MVR is angular momentum. Angular momentum is quantized. According to him, in the elliptical path, there will be a major axis, there will be a minor axis. N is the length of the major axis, K is the length of the minor axis. The length of the major axis and minor axis divided by the minor axis suggested a new term called orbitals. In the next video, we will see completely about the orbitals, what are orbitals, and quantum numbers. Thank you.